As already told you, these are the functions of the kidney to keep the water balance and to keep electrolyte balance, sodium, potassium, chloride, bicarb. Acid-base balance is important, and removal of the nitrogenous waste material like urea and creatinine. Kidney has got also endocrine function like activation of the vitamin D, that is vitamin D3, 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol, and it has got important function to produce the hormone that is called erythropoietin. This erythropoietin hormone causes erythropoiesis, that causes increased production of the red blood cells. So when the kidneys are affected, the patient become anemic due to erythropoietin deficiency or due to vitamin D deficiency. Mineral bone disease takes place or renal osteodystrophy takes place. So dialysis is the, basically there is the dia means through, lysis means a filtration through a semi-permeable membrane. Basically it is a Greek word. There are various types of the dialysis. One is hemodialysis. Hemodialysis, heme means blood, dialysis means filtration of blood, means solutes and extra water is removed and again re-entered in the body. It is also called the artificial kidney. APD is called acute peritoneal dialysis. This peritoneal dialysis is indicated in the acute renal failure or in the acute conditions. It is a temporary dialysis. Other form is CAPD, continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. Basically, this dialysis is indicated in end-stage renal disease when the patient requires permanent hemodialysis or renal transplant. Either patient put on the CAPD or maintenance hemodialysis, regular dialysis. In CAPD, this in which the trench cap catheter is inserted in the peritoneal cavity and by peritoneal solution, various sessions of dialysis has been conducted to remove the solutes and the extra water. It is also home dialysis, continuous ambulatory, patient can walk. Other form of the hemodialysis is dialysis, is a part which is usually applied in the ICU patients, in critical care units, when the patient develops acute kidney injury, that is called CRRT, continuous renal replacement therapy, in which the 20 to 24 hours or 12 hour dialysis takes place slowly with low blood flow, because in case of other form of dialysis like in the hemodialysis machine, so patient hypotension can occur, but in CRRT this is another separate machine in which hypotension doesn't take place. So these are the various form of the dialysis. Now coming to the indication of the dialysis, whatever the dialysis, either hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis. So the indications are the uremic syndrome. Uremic syndrome, when the nitrogenous waste material present in the blood and cause the uremia, means a patient can become drowsy, persistent vomiting, uremic symptoms, so then it is indicated, or when potassium is high, it is acute emergency, hyperkalemia or severe acidosis or pulmonary edema. Fluid overload is pulmonary edema. So we should not challenge the pulmonary edema due to renal aneurysm, because always these patients require the dialysis. Uremic pericarditis, not another viral or bacterial pericarditis, but due to uremia, sometimes pericarditis can develop in these patients, so dialysis should be done in these patients. Then the chronic dialysis, which is done in case of end-stage renal disease. End-stage renal disease are those patients in which the creatinine clearance is less than 10 ml per minute. When the patient develop end-stage renal disease, whatever the cause, we should do the either maintenance hemodialysis or renal transplant. Other indications of the dialysis, like drug intoxication, hypothermia, hypercalcemia, and metabolic alkalosis. Relative contraindication to dialysis therapy, though these patients require dialysis, but there are relative contraindications, like in old age, dementia, multi-infarct dementia, Alzheimer's disease, or HRS, hepatorenal syndrome, or advanced malignancy, advanced cirrhosis with encephalopathy. Now, what are the principles on which dialysis act? There are some physiological principles of dialysis. Basically, dialysis is a process where the solute composition of solution A is altered by exposing solution A to second solution B through a semipermeable membrane. So the mechanism of solute transport depend on the diffusion and ultrafiltration gradient. So concentration and diffusion depend upon the molecular weight of the substance and membrane resistance. Ultrafiltration means removal of the water. When patient in pulmonary edema, ultrafiltration depend upon the hydrostatic pressure and the osmotic pressure. So these are the physiological aspect regarding the dialysis. Now coming to the what are the apparatus of hemodialysis. Because hemodialysis setup should be present in the hospital, there should be dialysis hall and RO system, various dialysis machines, dialyzer, water for dialysis treatment, that is purified water, and dialysis solution and dialysis machine. These are the components of the hemodialysis. If you see the, this is the dialyzer. So there are, in case of end-stage renal disease, the patient who is on dialysis maintain AV fistula, arteriovenous fistula is formed. There are two lines, arterial line and venous line. Okay. So blood goes from the arterial line and move from the venous line. Here the suction pump, and from RO there is water, conductivity, temperature, and these are the concentration. So these are the various component of the dialyzers. This is slide shows the arterial line and the venous line. This picture of our patient in our department of nephrology, JPMC. She's on dialysis. This is the practical patient. End stage renal disease. You see on the hemodialysis machine, and two lines, arterial line, one two plasters, and venous line. After that, as already said, purified water. Water for dialysis treatment, because each patient is exposed about 120 liter of water during each dialysis treatment. And small molecular weight substance present in the water, so it is important to purify the water. The contaminants which are present in the water, these are aluminum, copper, chloramine. If you can't purify the water by RO system, the bone disease, anemia, and progressive neurological deterioration may occur. So aluminum can cause, and copper can cause the hemolytic anemia. Chloramine is a chemical that frequently used to control the bacterial contaminant of water. Sometimes it also can lead to complications during the dialysis. So now, what are the methods of the purifying the water? RO system, we heard this RO system, which is installed even in the good setup of the apartments, or because the function of this is to purify the water, it remove more than 90% the impurities. After the purification of water, we need the dialysis solution for the dialysis. There are two types of the dialysis solution. One is acetate, other is the bicarbonate. Nowadays, acetate is replaced by bicarbonate. The beauty of bicarbonate, it does not cause the hypotension and it does not cause the nausea, vomiting. The acetate can cause the vasodilatation, hypotension, and a nausea vomiting, so it is majority of the setup is replaced by bicarbonate. If you see the composition is almost same, sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium, almost same. Only in the acetate, you see the acetate portion is 35 to 38, but in the bicarbonate which is present is the 35 to 38. Otherwise, composition is same. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis? Because hemodialysis is a short treatment time, 4 hours, thrice a week. But peritoneal dialysis is a long duration of the treatment. CAPD, continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. Hemodialysis is highly efficient for small solute removal, and peritoneal dialysis is highly effective for large solute removal. Blood pressure is better controlled in peritoneal dialysis. Hemodialysis are usually performed in the dialysis hall, so there are so many patients which are in the dialysis that are coming for dialysis thrice a week. So usually these patients meet with each other and they can discuss their issue. So socialization occurs in the dialysis center. We can use intraperitoneal solution, and dialysis is a source of nutrition. But it is good advantage. It is the self-care form of therapy. Even it can be done at home. So coming to the disadvantages, hemodialysis require the anticoagulant and heparin, need vascular access in temporary internal jugular catheter, IJ catheter, or femoral catheter. In permanent or maintenance hemodialysis, end-stage renal disease patient require AV fistula or AV graft. Hypotension is usually occur due to fluid removal or ultrafiltration. Blood pressure fluctuation may occur. These patients require the diet and treatment schedule. If you see the on left side, the complication disadvantages of the peritoneal dialysis. Peritonitis sometimes occur. Obesity, because glucose is more in this patient. Dyslipidemia. If the patient can't take proper diet due to peritonitis, sometimes malnutrition occur. Hernia formation, back pain is the complication of the disadvantages of the peritoneal dialysis. Now coming to the, so we have discussed the dialysis, types of the dialysis, indication of the dialysis, physiological principle of the dialysis, requirement for the dialysis, setup for dialysis, RO system, dialysis solution. Then, and what are the acute complications of the hemodialysis? Because our topic is hemodialysis, its type and complications. Now coming to the last portion is the complications. Major complication in the hemodialysis usually seen is the hypotension. It is a multifactorial, either due to more ultrafiltration removal or more solute removal, or due to vasodilatation. Second is the muscle cramps, again due to more ultrafiltration, more solute removal. Nausea, vomiting can occur in these patients due to DDS, dialysis disequilibrium syndrome. Headache may occur, chest pain, and due to Lyme, IJ catheter, sometimes fever, chills. Intractable itching sometimes occur in these patients due to, which is all again multifactorial, hyperphosphatemia, or due to heparin anticoagulant, or due to dialyzer reaction, or due to dialysis solution. If you can't use the proper anticoagulant, clotting may occur, or due to low blood flow, or problem in the fistula, clotting may occur. Sometime fits, seizures can occur in these patients, that is also multifactorial. Hemolysis, due to various causes. If the blood pressure shoot up, these patients can develop intracranial bleed. So infectious disease are major cause of morbidity and mortality in patients on long-term maintenance hemodialysis. We should control the infections. What are the factors that contribute to infection? Because these patients of end-stage renal disease are immunocompromised, malnutrition, diabetes, vascular access problem, or extracorporeal circulation, contamination, or not using the disinfection or sterilization, or universal precautions are not applied. Types of the infection, vascular access, subclavian or femoral catheter or IJ catheter, or in permanent AV graft, AV fistula, septicemia, endocarditis, meningitis may occur, pyrogen reaction, pneumonia, infected wound. So universal precaution to prevent the infections are any healthcare worker who might potentially come into contact with body fluid should be educated in infection control and treat all body fluid as though they are potentially infected. So we should use the protective barriers, gloves, gowns and masks. You see, nowadays due to pandemic coronavirus, these are protective barriers are used, mask very important, and healthcare worker gown and gloves. So these three are very important to avoid the contamination or prone to infections. We should properly dispose the needles, and we should proper sampling of these things, proper handling of this problem. Now coming to the hypotension, that is a common cause, various factors that leads to hypotension. One is related to excessive decrease in blood volume or removal of more water from the body, ultrafiltration rate. Why ultrafiltration? Ultrafiltration means removal of the more water from the body. Our target dry weight say too low. Dry weight, concept of dry weight. Dry weight means on this weight, patient is asymptomatic, no hypotension, and patient can perform his routine life, and he can eat good. So that is called target dry weight. If you keep low, then dialysis technician will remove the more water, the patient can develop hypotension. Or dialysis sodium, if you keep low, so hyponatremia, patient can develop hypotension. Other causes, when vasodilatation occur or lack of vasoconstriction. Already told you, acetate containing dialysis solution. Dialysis solution if is warm, or during dialysis, if the patient take the food, especially in the diabetic patient or autonomic neuropathy, splenic vasodilatation occur, so hypotension. Tissue ischemia due to adenosine mediated, aggravated by low hematocrit anemic patient, autonomic neuropathy. Always we should counsel to the patient, you should not take the antihypertensive medication on the, suppose the patient in dialysis in the morning, he or she should avoid the antihypertensive medication in the morning dose. After dialysis, when she go to the home, in the evening she should check the blood pressure, if it's high, then she should take the dose. Otherwise, on the day of the dialysis, usually antihypertensive medication should be avoided. Some cardiac factors are ischemic heart disease and drugs, and due to left ventricular dysfunction, that also lead to hypotension. Uncommon causes of hypertension. We are discussing detailed hypotension because it is the common cause of acute complication of the hemodialysis. Sometimes uncommon causes, pericardial tamponade, myocardial infarction, occult hemorrhage, septicemia, arrhythmia, dialyzer reaction either A or B, anaphylactic hemolysis or air embolism, that leads to hypotension. Now, if any patient who develop the hypotension, how will you treat the hypotension? First of all, prevention of hypotension during dialysis. Ultrafiltration controller should be working, or it should be properly checked to remove the water properly or not. Patient education, weight gain in the 24 hours, less than 1 kg per day. They maintain the dry weight, dialysis sodium at or above the plasma level. Already told you, antihypertensive medication she should take or he should take after dialysis, not before dialysis. if patient develop dialysis, if the patient develop hypotension due to acetate solution, then it should be replaced by the bicarbonate. And we should reduce the dialysate temperature, that is 34 to 36, because if more temperature, it causes the vasodilatation hypotension. Keep the patient hematocrit 25 to 30%. During dialysis, we should avoid the heavy meals and drinks and frequent monitoring of the blood pressure. So these are the preventive aspects of hypotension during dialysis. Now, if any patient would develop hypotension, how will you manage this patient? We should keep the patient the position, Trendelenburg position, means head down and leg upwards, because the blood circulation due to towards the heart patient, it is the best tool to control the hypotension. And we should give the saline 0.9% bolus 250, not responding 500, which should reduce the ultrafiltration rate, reduce blood flow, and give the oxygen to the patient. So these are the management points regarding the hypotension during dialysis. After hypotension, muscle cramps causes same hypotension, low dry weight, low sedum. So we should correct blood pressure. We should use hypertonic saline or glucose. Exercise massage, sometime in the long term, quinine sulfate may be used to prevent the muscle cramps. Nausea, vomiting, multifactorial, and we should treat the patient symptomatically and antiemetic, and we should ask the patient, the patient should not take the meals during dialysis. Itching. Itching, various causes of itching, it is a very common but episodic, due to uremic toxin, xerosis, dry skin, drug or transfusion reaction, dialyzer reactions, dialysis solution reactions due to heparin. These patients are immunocompromised, they can develop the scabies, or in the hyperphosphatemia, hypocalcemia, raised PTH, means secondary hyperparathyroidism. Allergens, already told you, heparin, ethylene oxide. Now this is the acute complication of dialysis. Sometime patient can develop dialysis disequilibrium syndrome, that is called DDS. Basically, if you perform the dialysis over enthusiasm, you remove the more solute quickly, there is a difference between the tonicity of the CSF and extracellular fluid. So extracellular fluid, you remove the more solute, become hypotonic, so move to the CSF brain cell, so it can cause the cerebral edema. So patient can develop symptom, depend upon the mild and severe. I always give the example of the dialysis. Dialysis is just like if you initiate the dialysis, like aeroplane. If you see the aeroplane on the runway, first go slowly and take off slowly and gradually. When the aeroplane land, again slowly and gradually. So dialysis is just like that. So we should not be over enthusiastic. We should not aggressive regarding dialysis. So symptom, nausea, vomiting, restlessness, headache, fits, drowsiness, common, depend upon the severity. So prevention, always slow initiating of the dialysis. How will you manage these patients if they develop reduced blood flow, short dialysis session, hypertonic sodium or glucose, and severe discontinued dialysis and emergency measures? Sometimes these patients require ICU. Hemolysis also often multifactorial due to contaminant solution, copper, chloramine, nitrates, or sometimes, you know, mechanical trauma, this tube is kinked, needle trauma. So there are multiple drugs that cause hemolysis in this patient. This slide show, I'm sorry, maybe it is a faded slide, but it's very important. What are the causes of hemodialysis associated seizures or fits? The patient is on dialysis. He or she during dialysis may develop fits. So what are the causes? First, we should check the drugs. Because dialysis removal of the anticonvulsant, any patient who has got history of epilepsy and taking the anti-epileptic drugs during dialysis, these drugs are removed. So patient can develop the fits or other drugs. Metabolic causes, sometimes hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, hypoglycemia or hyperosmolarity caused by hypernatremia, severe acid-base disturbances, uremic encephalopathy, DDS, hypertensive encephalopathy. So these are the various contributing factors. Some cerebral anoxia, cardiac arrhythmia, sepsis, hemorrhage, or intracranial bleed, patient can develop fits. Iron deficiency, anemia occur in the hemodialysis patients due to depletion of the iron stores, chronic blood loss, because in the dialyzer, the blood can loss up to 120 ml. In each session, so patient can develop the iron deficiency or decreased dietary intake or iron demand is increased. So discussing the acute complication of the hemodialysis, then what are the long-term complications of the hemodialysis? If you can't do the dialysis properly, that is called the adequate dialysis, patient can't take the proper dye, so patient may develop the anemia, normocytic normochromic anemia, or iron deficiency anemia, or megaloblastic anemia, renal osteodystrophies because hypocalcemia, hyperphosphatemia, and raised PTH that cause secondary hyperparathyroidism, sometimes tertiary hyperparathyroidism that leads to renal osteodystrophies, aluminum toxicity cause again bone problems, but nowadays due to good RO system, this aluminum toxicity never happens because in reverse osmosis system, ultrafiltration of the water takes place. This aluminum is also filtered. So, on long-term dialysis, more than 10 years, patient can develop dialysis-related renal cyst or dialysis-related renal amyloidosis due to deposition of the amyloid tissue in the kidney. So other hepatitis can occur if you can't vaccinate these patients properly. Prophylaxis vaccination for hepatitis B, it is usually done As you know, for the hepatitis C, there is no vaccine. So what are the manifestation of the beta 2 microglobulin amyloidosis? Osteoarthropathies may occur in this patient. Periarthritis in scapula, humeral carpal tunnel syndrome, plexartenosynovitis. If his amyloid tissue are deposited in the spine, so destructive spinal arthropathies may occur, and extradural amyloid deposit, bone cyst, pathological fractures. So this is the last slide that shows these hands, you know, in the case of the amyloidosis, dialysis, arthropathies. The left synovial tissue shows the amyloid deposition. And this slide on the left side, the deposition of amyloid. Congo red stain is usually used to confirm the amyloid tissue, because Congo red has got the penetration, and this is the presence of amyloid on the bottom, is the carpal tunnel syndrome. So this is all about regarding the what is dialysis, what are the types of the dialysis and its complications, types and complications we have discussed as a whole in the detail. So thank you very much. If you ask any question, you are most welcome at the Department of Nephrology, JPMC. Thank you.